faith, I can run through a tree and leap over a wall. By faith, I have my healing. By faith, I will be strong. By faith, amen. I will have power over demons. By faith, I will speak with new tongues. I will say things in the spirit that I never dreamed that I could say. I will speak in tongues. I will interpret tongues. I will prophesy. Hallelujah. I will be used of God. And I'm not saying just for me. When I'm saying I will do this, I mean, here am I. I am George. And I'm into you doing this. When I say I mean us. Us.
Amen.
Because we are the family of God.
Yep.
The family, the actual God. The God that spoke. Do you know the Bible was God spoke the words that we're reading. God spoke these words. God is the author. God, I can't stress this enough, God is the author of this book. There's no book like this book on earth. This is the only one. I've read parts of the Quran. Oh God, deliver us. It's the most boring book I think I've ever read. Doesn't have any comparison to the teachings of this word. That God is the author of this book. Isn't it amazing? You kind of start reading Matthew. You're reading Matthew. And the stories go from one story to the next, to the next, to the next, to the next, with the least amount of words, not like me. If I'm writing the book, God forbid, but if I'm writing the book, it's going to be, it isn't going to be concise like that. Do you realize how concise the Bible is? It wastes no words, and yet every element that is needed and is necessary is in that story. Every element that is necessary to build your life is in that book, in stories. God isn't going to bore you with sermons. He is telling you stories. This book is God is the author. We are his children. He's writing a love letter to us. He's writing instruction to us. He's saying, you want to know me?
Yeah.
First, I want you to know me through this book.
Yeah.
Amen.
And when the book becomes flesh in you, when you conquer yourself, then you can begin to conquer the world around you. Hallelujah. Praise God. So, I went to the memorial service and I stated the scripture, run to win. Exclamation point.
Yep.
And we use this scripture, let us run with, you know, and King James says patience. Patience? Let us run with patience? What does that mean? I've never seen a runner run with patience. So the New Living Translation says, let us run with endurance. Oh, now it makes sense. If you're a runner, you know that. You want endurance. I mean, some runners can run 100 yards. Great. That's it. But this is not a sprint. There are times when we may sprint a little bit. This is an endurance. So let us run with endurance the race that God has set before us. I wear my shirt and I'm running in the race. People are passing me, you know. Oh, I like the t-shirt. Yeah, thanks. I appreciate you wearing that. I've had them when I was running through hell. People said, I like the t-shirt. See you later at the finish line. Who am I racing with anyway?
Right.
I'm racing with me.
Right.
I'm racing with the clock.
Right.
I'm not racing with these other people.
Right.
I'm racing with me. And if I can run the best that I know how to run on that particular day,
yeah.
I'm happy with that. Yeah. But if I'm just dogging it,
yeah.
You know, I can't be happy with that.
No.
Run to win. Run to win with what? Against whom? Against this guy right here.
Right.
If I can win against George, hallelujah, I'll be getting someplace.
Yeah.
So, I love you so much. I love this church. I want this church to go on. I want this church to be blessed.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. It's not my church. I don't want it to be my church. I want to be the Lord's church. And He's raising you up. All of us up. What are we going to do? Wow. We have people living in Jackson, Brooklyn, all these places. Good places. And then we come here and what?
Weberville.
Anybody ever heard of Weberville? Only ducks live there.
Went there for some hors d'oeuvres one time.
What?
I said I went there for hors d'oeuvres one time.
Hallelujah. We could start churches anywhere we want to.
Yeah.
The Lord wants us to do that. Passing out tracts, passing out those little cards, you know, yesterday. That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Mike, you're an example to us. Let's get the word out.
Yeah.
Now, I met a guy at the race. He came in second place overall. He was over at our place, drinking our coffee, eating our donuts, etc. And he said, you know, I go to 242. And he said, my wife was not a Christian, and now she's come to Christ. She received the Lord. What am I going to do? Ah, two. But that beautiful man came to the Lord and be ministered to, and his wife comes to the Lord.
Yeah.
What am I going to say?
Right.
I have to, so I congratulate him.
Right.
Good for you.
Absolutely.
I'm happy for you. We have to. Anybody who names the name of Christ. Anybody who names the name of Christ. Paul said, some preach Christ of contention.
Right.
Some are contentious. They're just contentious. Mm-hmm. Everybody's wrong but us. Mm-hmm. Some preach Christ of contention. But we preach Him out of love.
Right.
Amen. Amen. And he said, so anybody who names Christ, he said, I rejoice over this.
Right. Mm-hmm.
Carolyn Meads met up one of the pastors of a Methodist church. Is Methodist church? I think it's Chilson Hills Baptist Church. Oh, they gave one another a big hug. They were glad to see one another as chaplains. Isn't that good?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
We have to maintain, we have to walk a very straight path with the Lord. We have to walk and keep our theology in the Bible.
Yep.
I'm not saying everything I say forever is all right. I'm just saying stick with the Bible. Because we're here to influence the world to stick with the Bible.
Yes.
Amen? And, but, anyone who names the name of Christ, we should not see them as, we're all split up and different and everything like that. Because of the faith, faith equalizes everything. That is, if you have faith, even though you don't see the answer, you already have it. It's yours. Salvation. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. Of course, they took him once he did that. They took him the same hour of the night and baptized him. Him and all his. That's the ones that the Lord sends into our life. We're going to tell them that. I see somebody who believes on the Lord Jesus Christ, I'm going to tell them, now you're ready to be baptized in Jesus' name. And somebody, Carolyn talked to me the other day on the telephone, going to get re-baptized. And I said, well, why get re-baptized? You've already been baptized that way once.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not for me to be the judge of anyone, just to pray for them. And one last thing, I will read this to you. Because I think the Lord wants to make this clear. Maybe I should put on some glasses. And I'm going to let you go. I am going to let you go. I always say that. I lied to you. These six things doth the Lord hate. Yea, seven are an abomination to him. A proud look. By the way, this is in Proverbs chapter 6, verse 16. A proud look. Oh boy. God just doesn't. A lying tongue. The seed that prospers is a seed that falls into an honest and good heart. You have to have, you have to be honest with yourself. You'll never make it if you don't, if you're not honest with yourself. You gotta be honest. It has to. The seed fell into an honest and good heart. That's what brought forth fruit. If we're not honest and good, we have to work on that one, to be honest. And you're not fooling God. I'm not fooling God. There's no use trying to fool God, right? Might as well tell me exactly what it is. I can't fool him like I'm telling him one thing, but I really, you know, hope he doesn't see the other. No, a whisper here sounds on a loudspeaker in heaven, I think. A proud look, a lying tongue, hands that shed innocent blood. How terrible is that? And heart that deviseth wicked imagination. Sit around thinking of things like that. Feet that are swift in running to mischief. Just can't stay out of trouble. A false witness that speaketh lies. He that soweth discord among brethren. Probably one of the most disastrous things is to sow discord. Now, I'm going to go to a convention of apostolic people pretty soon. If I were to go there and start sowing discord, division, God hates that.
Right.
So what do I do? I go there, I'm going to love everybody, give everybody a big hug. Hallelujah. We can all bring up the stuff from the past, but it's not going to help us.
Right.
The Lord told me when I greet somebody, and I try to do this, I greet them like, yes. Not like.
Right.
I'm happy to see you. Now, this is a test. Sometimes we'll be tested on these things. So, we have to work on it. Anyway, let's stand. Hallelujah. Let's believe the Lord, because the currency of God, I mean, how much money do you have in your pocket? Did you come here with $5? Did you come here with no dollars? Did you come here with $200 or $300 in your pocket? That's the world's currency, right? Well, the people that have a lot of money in their pocket are not worried about lunch. They're not worried, you know, they're not worried about the things that are coming up. What about faith? The faith is the currency of God. Mm-hmm. How much faith? How much faith? What are you good for? A few hundred? $5? $1,000? $10,000? Unlimited? What are you good for? There is nothing impossible to them that believe. Nothing impossible to them that believe. How much of it? How much money are you willing to put on this one? You know what I mean? It's like your currency of faith. Hallelujah. I'm going to ask my chaplain friend to dismiss us in prayer. That's Carolyn.
Well, I just have to share this morning, because this has been on my mind all day long, and I didn't want to say anything about it, but it might be something that the Lord wanted to give a message to us, because He really magnified it to me this morning, and it's been on my mind the whole time I've been at church. It's like, there. And when He was talking about how much faith do you need, you know, well, faith is just a grain of mustard seed.
Mm-hmm.
It's the tiniest seed in the whole world.
Starts off that way.
It's the tiniest seed. But when it's planted, it becomes this huge tree. And He said, if you have this tiny bit of faith, you can say that mountain, be now removed and be cast into the sea. And not doubt in your heart, but you'll have the things that you say, what you believe. And the aspect of this, though, that I've been pondering, because He was teaching the people there on the shores of Galilee. He was saying the kingdom of heaven is like this tiny grain of mustard seed. The kingdom of heaven is like this tiny grain of mustard seed sowed into the earth, and then it becomes this huge tree, and it fills everything, this huge tree. And then it says that the birds of the air come and they nest in that tree. And I thought, well, what are they, you know, what's the significance of that? Because I understand about Jesus being planted and the tree that fills all the earth, that's the faith. That it was just a little bit of faith, that this faith fills the whole earth. And I understand that. I was trying to think about in our own life that abundance of it, as it grows and matures, that faith becomes this big tree. And then it says there are birds of the air that come to nest in it. And you know, there's another parable that talks about the birds that come and steal the seed. And it relates that to the evil one. And, you know, I'm not sure of all the interpretation, but I could just see birds come and nest in our tree. Why? They want to get at the fruit in our lives.
Yeah.
What is the fruit in our lives? The fruit of the Spirit. joy,
yeah,
the peace, the long suffering, the gentleness, the goodness, the temperance, the faith, that immature fruit that's growing in each of our lives, there are birds, spirits, that want to nest in your branches and get at that fruit.
So we need to shake the branches.
So we have to say, fly away. We have to shake the branches, and we have to say to the devil, get out of here, I'm not going to be saved.
What will really shake the branches is a big wind.
But we literally have to recognize that there are birds that come after the fruit, and we must shoo them away.
Mm-hmm.
We must, okay, get out of here. I'm not, you know, I've got this faith, and I'm, you know, I am not putting up with anything that comes to take the fruit of the Spirit out of my life.
Yeah, we should be here. We're not roosting here.
That's right. That's what we gotta say. You're not roosting here.
Hallelujah.
He asked me not to talk. He asked me to this business.
When have you ever? No, don't chase him.